Welcome to Perspectives. On today's show, we're filming in the spring of 2004, and I want to remind everyone to get out on April 17th and vote in the town elections. Today's guest is Freddie Shine, born and bred Wilmington resident, and we're going to talk a little bit about Grove Avenue after the opening. Welcome to Perspectives. Today's guest is Fred Shine, born and bred Wilmington resident. He grew up on Grove Ave, and he has some issues he wanted to discuss. So welcome, Fred.
Thank you for having me here today. I appreciate it very much.
Tell me a little bit about yourself.
I grew up in Wilmington, born and raised, delivered by Dr. Fagan, back when doctors made house calls. I went to Wilmington High School, graduated in 1967. Cool. After which I volunteered for the military, did two tours of duty in Vietnam, came back to Wilmington. I established the monuments for the four kids that were killed in Vietnam.
Right.
I went on to Middlesex Community College, got my my Associate of Science degree in Business Administration. From there, I went on to Boston College, where I studied marketing and communications. Mm-hmm. I'm the president, CEO of Eagle Meal Company in Billerica. I've been owner of that company for 18 years. Mm-hmm. I'm also a licensed real estate agent. I belong to the Greater Lakes Region Board of Realtors in New Hampshire.
Good.
And I've been active in Wilmington most of my life. My roots are in Wilmington. I have a lot of family still in Wilmington, so I consider Wilmington my town.
Great. Thank you. I know in high school you had some locally famous, at least,
people
that you grew up with.
David Weary, who was on Channel 5 News, graduated in our class. He was our class president.
Okay.
Mike Kyra, town manager of Wilmington, was in our graduating class.
Oh, great.
And Richard Welch, who was killed in action with the 173rd Airborne Brigade in September of 1968.
Great. And you had mentioned that while you were with the DAV, you were instrumental in the four monuments for the...
The four monuments, when I came back from Vietnam, there were no monuments for any of the kids that were killed.
Mm-hmm.
I decided they should have them.
Right.
I worked with the selectman, in particular, Rocco DiPasquale, who, unbelievable work and time he put in to help me do this, and Bob Palmer with the Highway Department, who is the person responsible for the black granite on each of those, which came from the Vietnam Veterans Memorial in Washington. Bob, countless hours, unbelievable help doing it.
Great.
And the people of Wilmington.
The people of Wilmington, help. Right.
And the kids who donated.
And for those that don't know, where are the four monuments?
There's, the first one is down by Bridge Lane. That was for Richard Welch, 173rd Airborne, killed September 1968. The second monument was for John Fullerton, killed at the fall of Saigon during the Tet Offensive. Jack was wounded three times. He helped stop the VC overrun of the Saigon, went on to the ambassador's residence where him and nine others were hit with an anti-tank rocket and killed.
Okay.
Bobby Parents is down at the Old Town Hall in Wilmington. Bobby was with the 1st Air Cavalry Division, had the Meritorious Commendation Medal. He had the Air Medal with 13 oak leaf clusters, a Bronze Star.
Great.
And the other one was for John Rich, who was a Marine Corps. First one from Wilmington killed in 1966. His monument is across from the town crier off Route 129.
Great. Thank you. I even know that at some of the openings of some of the monuments, you had some pretty famous guests then, too, right?
I had a lot of senators. I had Governor King, who actually flew into Wilmington, landed his helicopter at Rotary Park.
Really?
For the dedication.
That can't. That must not have happened very often in Wilmington.
I think that's the first time it ever happened.
Okay.
I had Paul Tsongas, who, if people remember, ran for President of the United States, and I had the honor of having him sit at my kitchen table and have coffee with me.
Great, great.
And a lot of former senators, Senator Bob Buell, great person. Jim Maselli made absolutely every single dedication, and the families.
Great.
And the people.
Great.
Those are my pride and joys.
Excellent. And you mentioned a little bit about your professional experiences. So let's skip right on. Why are you here? What's the topic today? What's your perspective on what's going on?
My perspective is there's a lot of things going on within the town of Wilmington that people who should be doing the job are not doing. They don't want people to know about it, and they'll do anything they can to avoid it.
Okay.
In particular, building. And you can ride through Wilmington, you can see these houses all of a sudden popping up in places before you couldn't build houses. All of a sudden, swampland is filled in. A big high-rise, I call a high-rise, a trophy home pops up. And people ask, how'd it get there? It didn't belong here.
People call them McMansions.
McMansions. We call them, and up at Winnipesaukee, where my other house is, we call them trophy homes.
Trophy homes. Okay.
Trophy homes. Well, my problem was with a house that my mother owned, and now I own, on Grove Avenue.
The house you grew up in?
Actually, it was a house that was my grandparents.
Okay.
I'm the third generation owner, and my son's hoping to get it. He'll be the fourth generation in that house.
Great.
The house next door was razed down. In other words, totally torn down, foundation, everything removed, and a new house put in.
Okay.
And, of course, everyone has a right to do that. You know, it's your property. You want to
build a
house.
We're seeing it more and more, especially in some of the older neighborhoods where they tear down the house. They buy the property for the property, tear down the house, and put it up. And, of course, this is facing the lake, so it's
Lakefront property, which is very nice to have.
Yep.
And the home that was put up, we noticed after the foundation was in, was too close to our lot line. I took a tape measure and measured it. It was about 11 feet off my lot line.
And in the zoning for that area should be?
By law, 20 feet.
Right.
And the way I came up with that, and it's right in the bylaws, in Wilmington you need 10,000 square feet and 100-foot frontage. The property next door is deeded to only have 11,189 square feet. And I don't know if you can zoom
that's
in.
Okay.
To see that.
I can read it. I can read it. That's good.
11,189 square feet, and it actually has a frontage of 74 feet,
right,
not 100. So by the new standards, it's not a buildable lot. But there's also a bylaw that says a pre-existing lot. Now, in the town of Wilmington, you can have a pre-existing lot, which means any house that was built prior to September 1934 has a pre-existing lot, as long as it's built by the bylaws from 1934.
Okay.
And in those bylaws, and I have a copy of the bylaws in all these documents I have, that says a house, number one, it can't consume more than 20% of the lot.
Okay.
And it has to have a sideline of 20 feet.
So undisputed. It still needs a 20-foot setback. Okay. And you said you personally measured this at 11.
I personally measured it. I slid a tape measure under my fence, touched the foundation, and ran it back to my property line. And it was about 11 feet. It's a few years ago, so I'll say between 11 and 13 feet.
Okay.
It's supposed to be 20.
Fair enough. Now, there's different documentation, I think, that you have that you showed me. I see you have a lot of documentation. You want to give us a real quick tour?
Three years of research, and there's no way you're going to get it all in 1 hour. So
right.
I'm going to hit basically the ones that involve that one particular piece of property, and I'm going to just leave the ones from the other people that have written me and sent me letters and correspondence for whenever someone wants to look at it.
Actually, that brings up a good point. Some of the correspondence that you have, obviously, is personal about this issue, but are you representing that this is actually a representative kind of problem in the town where a lot of other people that you are aware of
There's a lot of people have the exact same problems, especially the Silver Lake area, Glen Road, places where the summer cottages now, they're getting old. Mm-hmm. The elderly people that were living there were dying, and these developers want that land to build these superhomes. Mm-hmm. So they're kind of bending the laws to fit their needs and not the bylaws. And they're kind of ignoring the bylaws. And if you catch them on it, mm-hmm. they don't want to do anything about it. They don't even want you to say anything about it.
Gotcha.
And some of the documents have, and I've blown them up so you can see them.
Okay.
This first house, this is the first plot plan that was submitted for this house, and it was on September 27th of 1999. Mm-hmm. Now, if you remember, the deed says it has 11,189 square feet. Mm-hmm. You notice this says he has 53,324 square feet.
So that lot has somehow grown four times.
Yeah, I don't know if we had an earthquake and it just grew up and expanded, but
four times
didn't hear
over.
It.
Okay.
Now, there's also a street here that's not shown in this.
Okay.
And if you notice, and it's kind of important, it shows the sidelines of 15 feet mm-hmm. from this house to my lot.
Right. Your lot would be on the side where your hip fingers
would
are
be
now.
Over here. My lot okay. would be over here.
But so then, by either the older bylaws or the newer bylaws, that still wouldn't qualify.
Correct. In fact, there's another question. If you notice, your frontage is 94.29 feet.
It says 94 feet, right.
The deed says it's 75 feet. So where did this other
15
come
feet.
From?
Something's wrong. Where did the 20 feet come from?
And,
okay.
And also, at the top, you notice the building inspector, Dan Paré, put a note here. Street built 30-foot setback. So.
Right. There is some handwriting up here. It's very difficult to pick up in the camera. That's okay. Let's go on to the next topic then. Okay.
So somehow, Dan Paré, whose job is to enforce the building.
So he saw there was something wrong with this, and he
made
him go back and redraw it.
Made him go back and...
Okay.
Now, if you take the second plot plan, and I've blown these up again so you can see them, you can see he's corrected now to be 15,324 square feet. Mm-hmm. But the deed still says 11,189 square feet. And now, all of a sudden, the sideline between my property grew from 15 feet to 15 feet 8 inches and 16 feet.
Well, it looks like a different house that he had planned on there now.
Because of the bylaws from 1934, the house can't occupy more than 20% of the space.
So made two corrections at once.
Two corrections at once. And he put the street in. Now, that street, by his deed, is called Pine Street. Mm-hmm. There's an issue around that street, a neighbor adjoining, and a street at the end of Grove Ave called Cadillac Street. Mm-hmm. Somehow, lawyers for the town came in and took that land from this girl, gave it to these people, saying it was no longer a viable street, divided it in half, and gave it to him.
Okay.
But by the laws of the state, and again, I'm a real estate agent, so I know these, there's an issue called adverse possession. In 1908, the Union Ice House divided these properties up.
Okay.
There was a fence between this house that was ripped down and this other person's house. Since 1908, this person's father, grandfather, took care of that property.
I appreciate that, but that's on the other side.
Okay.
Let's talk about it.
But the issue was, somehow the town took that land and gave it to him. Now again, by bylaws.
Okay.
You cannot add that land into your plot.
Into the building lot.
Into
in other words, you can have access to that surface, but you can't build on it. Though.
You can't build it, and you still have to keep a setback to it.
Okay.
That's bylaw 5.3.2.
Right. Okay. So that's significant. So on this plot plan, I can see that the old street line, which is very important, but now they're saying it's 46 feet from one side and 15 feet 8 inches from the other side.
Correct.
But that still doesn't qualify.
No, it doesn't have 100-foot frontage, even if these dimensions are accurate.
Right.
And I want to point out, too, these are all done by a company called Troy Meat Associates.
Yes.
And all the documents that I've been finding in the town that are wrong, his stamp is on it. So there's something kind of funny.
Okay.
Well. All right. So now, after this plan came through, there was a third plot plan put in.
Okay.
This one was done in March 28th of 2000. Mm-hmm. There's that same house back again. After he was told he couldn't have it that big,
right.
He put it in anyway.
Okay.
Now, this house wasn't built. This is a prefabricated home that came on a flatbed truck, two flatbed trucks,
okay.
After the foundation was up, and all of a sudden it was thrown on there. Also notice the house extends into that street. By the bylaw, you can't build into that street. That's supposed to have a setback.
Right.
And it's built into the street.
Certainly appears that way.
And again, it's against the bylaws. The bylaws are very definite what's supposed to be done.
Now, was this building plan approved?
This one wasn't.
Okay.
This is the house that was approved for that lot.
Nice square little ranch, looks like.
Yeah. And okay. How do you know this house was approved?
Okay.
These are the plans. And I'm going to go right to the page. That shows the house that was approved.
Okay.
This is the house that was put up.
Okay. And then what's that little X on it mean?
These X's mean they're not approved. This one here is the only one that was approved.
Okay.
Now, approximately a month or so after this house was put up,
right,
another flatbed truck came.
Okay.
With an addition that enclosed like a porch and a two-car garage.
Okay.
I couldn't find any building permits to allow that to be put up. This was the only house that was approved.
Okay.
Now, and again, this big monster trophy home was put up.
Okay. Well, now,
extending into the street.
It certainly, the documentation seems to do that, but now it seems to show that. Who would be responsible for?
Well, your bylaws are supposed to be enforced by your building inspector.
Okay.
That's clearly written in the bylaws, 8.8.1.
Right.
That anything to do with the bylaws, it's purely the responsibility of the building inspector of the town to take care of that.
Mm-hmm.
Unequivocally, no questions, black and white, his job description, it's there. He
gotcha.
Claims it wasn't his job, that he has to accept these plans given to him by any surveyor that's certified.
Mm-hmm.
And I asked him who checks these to make sure that they actually put these stakes in or where things are or where they're supposed to be. Again, he claimed it wasn't his job.
Okay. So you perceived that there was some difference between the paperwork that you
100%.
Were able to find and what was actually happening.
Correct. In
you
fact,
brought it to the building inspector at the time.
Brought it to his inspector.
And he said that the paperwork is all he checks. Once the paperwork says it's okay, then it's okay. So
right.
he didn't want to do any kind of
nothing.
Field check to make sure that
in
the
fact,
two matched.
His exact words when I first brought it to his attention, and this was before the house was up, was I don't have to talk to you about anything on that house. The way we do it in Wilmington, you have to wait till the house is put up and they apply for an occupancy permit and then file your grievance and they have to apply for a variance. And I
gotcha.
Said, that makes no sense to tell someone to put a house up, put in the plumbing, put in the wiring, put in your furniture, and then say, oh, it's wrong, you gotta move it.
Okay.
He said, that's the way I run Wilmington.
Okay. Did you discuss with anyone else, or did you?
I went over his head, okay. Chain of commands, military. You take the lower and you go up and you up.
Right.
I went to the town manager,
right,
who the building inspector worked for.
Mm-hmm.
He refused to do anything about it. Absolutely bluntly refused to look at any of the documents I had.
Okay.
And again, reiterate, it's not Dan Perret's job to do this. Dan Perret's job, it seems to be, is just collect papers and file.
Well, speaking of that, I thought you had a paper from the town manager or to the town manager from the building inspector where the building inspector
yes,
said that everything was
hunky-dory.
Hunky-dory. That looks like it.
No,
that's okay.
It basically said the way that letter, in fact, came about
right.
is I went over Michael Kyra's, who was the town manager's head, and I went to the selectman.
Okay.
And I filed a complaint
mm-hmm.
that
with the board of selectmen.
The board of selectmen, who is Mike Kyra's, the town manager's boss.
Right. Okay.
I told him I had a complaint against Mr. Kyra
mm-hmm.
and Mr. Perret
mm-hmm.
for this instance.
Mm-hmm.
At the time, Mike Newhouse was the chairman of the Board of Selectmen.
Okay.
He gave the complaint to Mike Kyra to investigate.
Okay.
Who gave it to Dan Perret to investigate,
okay.
who sent me a letter mm-hmm. telling me that he looked into everything he did and everything he did was right. And everything was built to code.
Okay.
Everything was built by the bylaws and there was no discrepancies whatsoever.
But even the plans that we have here show that the bylaws are being complied with.
In black and white.
So even if the plans are accurate, which you contest, but even
correct.
If they were accurate, they're not in
they're
compliance
not.
With the bylaws your reading of the bylaws.
Correct. In fact, it shows the house to clearly be in the street, which the bylaw says you can't do.
Okay.
And he was allowed to do it.
And you're saying Dan Pere seems to indicate to you that he didn't feel that there was anything wrong?
Nope. He felt that he runs the town. He interprets the laws how he interprets them, and that's the way it is.
Okay. We'll set that aside.
Yeah.
I believe there was a second issue that was going on concurrently with this.
Concurrently.
Your mother was infirmed at the time, right?
My mother was quite ill. She was elderly.
Right.
She was in her late 80s. She had multiple strokes. And at the same time, myself, I got diagnosed with a mysterious bone blood disease. I had a massive tumor in my shoulder. Mm-hmm. I had a blood bacteria in my heart. I was on a pump for 6 weeks. I've lost 2/3 of my clavicle bone, and I lost part of my 7th and 8th rib.
Okay.
My mom had multiple strokes.
I hope you're feeling better now.
Well, that's another story.
Okay.
No. my mom had multiple strokes. She could no longer walk. She couldn't feed herself. I had to move all her bedding and everything downstairs. We couldn't get her in and out of the house to go to her doctor's appointments or even get out for fresh air. I went to a contractor. I wanted him to put a ramp in. I wanted him to take this little front porch off. And the front porch, it's about the size of a normal step.
Mm-hmm.
Put a wider door in that would let a wheelchair in and out.
Mm-hmm.
And put a flatbed landing,
mm-hmm.
no more than, I'd say, no higher than maybe 1.5 feet off the ground. So a wheelchair could get up, get my mother in and out of the house.
Right.
I sent a contractor from Bill Ricker, who did my bathroom at home, and I'm comfortable with his work, to Dan Pere's office to get a permit.
Mm-hmm.
By law, because he's a licensed contractor in the state, he has to have a permit to work on a building.
Right.
He didn't need one, because by the Architectural Access Board rules on the disabilities, you don't need all these things Dan Pere told him you needed. Dan Pere wanted a certified plot plan of my property. He wanted my land surveyed. He wanted 3 architectural and engineering drawings for a ramp. Well, the architectural board says all I have to do is make sure that ramp is 1 foot out for every inch up.
Mm-hmm.
There's absolutely no setback requirements. If my property went right to that fence and I needed a handicap ramp, it has to be built.
Mm-hmm.
And the person in charge of enforcing that is the building inspector of each town. Dan Pere refused to accept that permit. That's why there's a discrepancy that we never applied for it. He refused to take it. And we applied a number of times to try and get that permit. So one of the main things for me being here arguing this, the last 3 years of my mom's life, she was stuck in that house. When the ambulance came, they had to leave the stretcher outside. They had to carry her out through that door like a sack of flour under her arms and under her legs and put her into the stretcher to take to the hospital. And that's how she left that property when she died. Being carried out like a sack of flour. And this was all in an attempt to try and intimidate me to drop the issue and to go away.
Well, I'm sorry that happened. But let's get back to the details at hand.
Back to the details.
Unfortunately, a lot of these things get deeper and deeper sometimes instead of coming up. So let's talk about a couple simple little visuals to make it a little bit easier to understand your original complaint on that house.
Okay.
I see that we have on the board here, we have 2 documents. We'll go to the white one first. And that basically just shows the...
These are the lots when the Union Ice House in Wilmington subdivided these lots in 1908.
Okay.
This lot here is my lot.
Mm-hmm.
This is the lot in question where this house was built.
Now, for those watching, the lots are actually 3 of those little stripes.
Correct. Each one of these were divided into 25 feet, and each one of these lines are 25 feet wide.
Okay.
That's where they got the 75 feet that was deeded in his deed.
Right.
Now, next to it is Pine Street.
Right.
And unfortunately, I don't have the other map that shows Cadillac Street is way up here.
Okay. Well, that's okay. Well, if we stay right on that, you can see that
they're equal.
Your mother's lot...
Correct.
Your grandmother's lot, actually,
correct.
Is in the yellow.
Correct.
The lot in question is in the green.
The green.
And then the street that was divided is between the green property and the pink
and
property,
the pink property.
On that form. I got you.
And that goes between Cottage Street and Grove Avenue,
right,
which is the lake.
And if you look, you can actually see the shore of the lake there right at the top of the
correct.
Page.
Correct. Okay. Now, it's funny to point out that this property here, I put this line here, but it's a little bit wrong. This is also a beach. Each of these houses were deeded with beachfront properties.
Right.
His property actually comes over to here.
Okay, he's got the angle. Okay.
Which is 93.2 feet.
Which is
the same thing that was put on his certified plot plan.
But on the house side of the street, it's only 75 feet. On the rivers, on the lake side of the street, because of the curve, it's bigger.
Correct.
I got you. Okay, that's that piece of...
Now, this other piece of evidence I have...
This makes it a little easier to see sometimes. We actually have a satellite photograph of the area.
Right. I was able to go online and computer modelist. This is a satellite image of the property itself. This is Cottage Street.
Right.
This is Grove Avenue.
Right.
This is my house.
Right.
This is my garage.
Right.
And this is the house in question.
Well, now, even without being hidden by the trees, it certainly looks a lot larger than the other houses in the
area.
It's
larger than you think. This is a certified plot plan of that house, which I kind of transposed in the transparencies and put on.
Right.
Well, that's a brand new house. This house had to build, had to be built exactly what was on that plot plan.
Right.
So lining it up with Cottage Street.
Yeah.
And you can see the edges.
Right.
You can see this house extends way into these bushes, which is even bigger than you think it is.
Right, right.
Now, my property...
Okay, well, we're in the last 2 minutes, so let's...
Okay, my property is right here. This is the fence that divides my property. You can clearly see, and I'm not sure if they can see it.
Yeah.
My prop, for him to have the footage that he claims he has, comes way over here into my property.
And that would even... I can see the two lines. There's a dotted line and a solid line. But basically, even counting into your property, he's still not in compliance with the bylaw.
No, he's not in compliance at all.
And your complaints went to deaf ears.
Went to deaf ears. And probably Dan Prey will tell you that, he didn't know about it. He didn't do this. This is one of two documents I have. And I dropped it.
It's okay. We'll get it real quick.
Here, real quick.
Why don't you just hold it there with your hand?
I'll hold it here.
And we'll come in tight on it, because this is kind of
this is actually
crux of the point.
The building permit. And if you notice here, December 13th, 1999, 3 months before that house was even put on the foundation, Dan Prey's signature with a note, I suggest you have the surveyor certify the location of the foundation. It appears very close to the lot line. This is one of two documents with his signature on it, saying that he knew 3 months before that house was ever put up, it was too close. Now, he had an obligation when I went to him as a taxpayer and a landowner with a complaint to verify that when he told them to do it, they actually did it. And
well,
they did it.
I'm afraid we're out of time, but we're going to have to end with that piece.
Right.
I thank you very much for coming in.
Well, I thank you for having me.
You can let that drop. Don't worry about it.
Okay.
And thank you very much.
And I wish you all the luck in the world in the election.
Oh, thank you.
Everybody vote.
Everybody should vote on
April
17th.
April 17th.
2004.
That's what my friends went to the service for. Vote.
Very good. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And we'll see you guys next time.